Grace and peace to you, beloved of God, on this beautiful day of Pentecost, where we gather wherever we are to celebrate the birth of the church and the outpouring of the Spirit. Bonus points to all of you who dressed up in red, even if you're not here today. I think everyone here is in red. So, John's not. That's all right. He doesn't have to be. So last week on Sunday, I promised that you would get two mailings this week, and you might have noticed that you only got one, because I didn't quite get the second one done, but I will be finishing them all up today and getting them out tomorrow. So you'll get another mailing from me this week, promised this time. The one mailing that you did get was a letter from me and the coordination team kind of telling you where we are and our plan moving forward about reopening our sanctuary. Right now, our plan is to reassess every month and kind of see where we are. So that being said, we're going to continue live stream worship only through the month of June, and then the core team will be having another conversation at the end of June to reassess for July. So stay tuned, and we'll be giving you the updates for that. The other announcement that I want to make you aware of is today, as you may well know, was supposed to be our church picnic at Cerny Park. Even though the sun is shining, it's a little on the cool side. So we're going to be having a virtual church picnic on Zoom. If you would like to join, the information is in the email that you got this morning with the order of service. I don't know about you, but yesterday I already ordered my pizza that I'm picking up at noon, and I will be eating either in my house or on my porch starting at 12:30. So if you would like to join me beginning at 12:30 and going until whenever y'all want to hang out, we can gather on Zoom for a virtual church picnic. So just wanted to make you aware of those two things. Be sure to check your mailbox this week and join me on Zoom this afternoon for a church picnic. Any other announcements here? All right. And let us pray. Holy God, like a rushing wind and burning fire, your Spirit is still on the move today. Help us to keep up with her prophetic dance as she moves and breathes in us. In the power of your Holy Spirit, we ask you to speak to us in the language of our hearts that we might hear your word with understanding and answer your call with confidence. Holy God, may you take delight in our worship this morning, for it's in your holy name we pray. Amen. I now invite you to join me in this morning's call to worship. The fires of Pentecost are burning.
The Spirit is sweeping through our hearts.
Holy Spirit, set us on fire.
Fill our mouths with words of life.
Embolden us to speak of Christ crucified. Beloved of God, let us now sing on Pentecost they gathered.
See? And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all of the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance.
There were Jews living in Jerusalem, religious men who had come from every country in the world. When they heard this noise, a large crowd gathered. They were all excited because each one of them heard the believer speaking in his own language. In amazement and wonder, they exclaimed, "These people who are talking like this are Galileans. How is it then, that all of us hear them speaking in our own native languages?"
Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power.
So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "Whatever could this mean?" Others, mocking, said, "They are full of new wine."
But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and spoke out to them, "Men of Judea, and all of you who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. These men are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel.
In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy.
I will work wonders in the sky above. I will cause miraculous signs on the earth below. There will be blood, fire, and thick smoke. The sun will be changed into darkness, and the moon will be red as blood. And then the great and glorious day of the Lord will come. And everyone who trusts in the Lord will be saved.
People of Israel, hear this. Jesus of Nazareth was sent to you with miracles, portents, and signs as his credentials, which God performed through him in your midst, as you well know. Jesus was delivered up by set purpose and plan of God. You even made use of godless people to crucify and kill him. God freed him from death's bitter pains, however, and raised him up again. For it is impossible that death could keep its hold on him.
For David says about him, "I saw the Lord always in front of me, for he is at my right hand so that I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. My body also will live in hope because you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor permit your Holy One to experience decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will make me full of joy with your presence."
Fellow Israelites, I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, "He was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption."
God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, and has poured out what you now see and hear.
For David did not ascend to heaven, and yet he said, The Lord said to my Lord, Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah.
When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, Brothers, what shall we do?
And Peter answered them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of and release from your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to and for you and your children, and to and for all that are far away, and to and for as many as the Lord of God invites and bids to come to himself.
With many other words he warned them, and he pleaded with them, Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day.
They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all, as any had need.
Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people, and day by day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved.
Don't on me, smart child.
Thank you, Jody and Amy and Sue, for that beautiful prayer this morning. Dona nobis pacem. Grant us peace. Grant us peace. Grant us peace. May that be our Pentecostal prayer today. Let it be our prayer because the Spirit of Pentecost calls us to live into a story that's as empowering as it is uncomfortable. It's a story that fills our hearts with fire and our ears with words we may not understand or even want to hear. In the story of Pentecost, we hear the familiar call to repent, to reorient ourselves to the kingdom of God that changes how we relate to each other and the world at large. So God, grant us peace. Before we get into it this morning, I just want to take a moment to thank everyone who participated in the special reading of the second chapter of Acts that we just heard. It was beautiful to hear and see so many of you tell the story, because that is what Pentecost is all about. I watched all those clips a lot of times and the whole thing a lot of time, but hearing it again still brought tears to my eyes. Because by telling the story, we embody the spirit of Pentecost that empowered Jesus' followers to raise their voices and proclaim God's presence and promise in the world. Along with seeing your faces and hearing your voices, it was also great to hear the whole story of Pentecost for a change. I don't know about you, but my experience has been a tendency to focus on just the first few verses, to highlight the faithfulness of the disciples gathered in the upper room, and then to marvel at the rushing wind, the divided tongues of fire, and the multitude of other languages. And granted, that's a lot. But it's also just the very beginning. Sometimes, if we're feeling brave, we might go a little farther. We might struggle through that list of the various cities and regions and ethnicities that are represented. Great job to Dave Anderson. I gave him that on purpose. Or even we might smile or chuckle at how the spectators thought the speakers were drunk, even though it was only 9 o'clock in the morning. We might even read the first few lines of Peter's sermon, but then skip to the happy ending where we're told how 3,000 were added to their number that day. But typically we skip over the bulk of the chapter that records Peter giving the church's very first sermon. So it was powerful, at least for me, and I hope for you as well, to hear you, my brothers and sisters and siblings, proclaim the whole story and actually preach Peter's Pentecost sermon. It helped me hear these ancient words in a new way. And it also helped me make a connection between what's happening in the story this morning and something that happened in the last two resurrection stories we read in Luke's gospel not too long ago. Remember, the book of Acts is a continuation of the story that was started in the gospel of Luke. They're written by the same author. And back at the end of Luke, the writer made a point of saying how Jesus opened up the scriptures to his followers on two separate occasions. First, on the road to Emmaus, Jesus began with Moses and went through all the prophets, interpreting everything that had been written about the Messiah, opening up their hearts and minds in a new way. And then he does it again, Soon after appearing to the disciples right in the middle of the travelers telling the other disciples what happened on the road to Emmaus, Jesus shows up. He appears suddenly. He shows them his hands and his side. He asks for some food, remember, and then he eats some fish. But then we heard how he opened their minds to the scriptures, including Moses, the prophets, and even the Psalms this time. And with these two encounters of Jesus still fresh in our minds, you can see how Peter is doing the exact same thing here on Pentecost. In the light of his resurrection, Jesus took all the pieces of scripture that had been around for hundreds of years, he took them and he turned them just slightly. So the disciples would see the promise of the Messiah in a new and different light. He put the old pieces together in a new way to help them see how he was a different kind of Messiah. Not a military hero, not a conqueror that would overthrow the empire, but a humble servant and a teacher. And I imagine Jesus probably pointed to some of the same exact scriptures we now hear Peter reciting to the crowd. He begins by quoting the prophet Joel. In the days to come, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your daughters and sons will prophesy, your young people will see visions, and your elders will dream dreams. He goes on to also recite a few Psalms of King David as he tells the story of Jesus of Nazareth, who worked miracles and taught with authority and was living into the promise of ruling on David's throne in a new way. Peter does the same thing for the crowds that Jesus had done for him. He helped the crowd come to understand how Jesus was the Messiah, even though he wasn't at all the kind of Savior any of them were expecting. Jesus helped the disciples. Peter helped the crowd. Because we all need help sorting through the pieces of a complicated and unexpected story. We need help to recognize our own preconceived notions and to let go of our misconceptions. And we all need help to see a fuller picture of how God's at work in the world even today. After going through the scriptures, Peter ends with the powerful declaration for all people to know beyond any doubt that God made this Jesus, the one you hung up from a tree, both ruler and Messiah. And that cuts to the quick of it. Not only does it challenge the crowd to see Christ in the broken body of a man who was brutally killed, it also asks them to acknowledge their own complicity in his killing. So when the crowd heard this, Scripture tells us how they were cut to the heart. They didn't respond with excuses or lash out in self-righteous anger. They didn't cover up their ears or look away. Scripture says they were cut to the heart. And they cried out to Peter, asking that age-old question, "What shall we do? Brothers, what shall we do? Given everything you've just told us, given how you've opened our minds to a different way of understanding the world, given our ignorance and our own complicity in the death of God's beloved child, what shall we do?" And Peter doesn't hesitate to give them an answer. "Repent," he tells them. "Be baptized and reborn in the name of Jesus the Messiah, that your sins may be forgiven. And we know this call to repent. If you remember, we spent some time with it a few months ago. It was Jesus' first sermon, and it was at the heart of all of his teachings. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. Reorient yourself to God's desire for creation. Turn away from those things that don't cultivate life. Humble your heart and open your mind to receive a fuller understanding of how God is present and at work in the world. If you've turned on the TV in the past day or two, the past few weeks even, we've watched as the killing of Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, and George Floyd have sparked protests and fanned into flames fires of outrage that have long been stoked by generations of racism, oppression, and the dehumanization of black and brown bodies. This isn't the kind of fire we expected on Pentecost. This isn't the story we are used to hearing, but Pentecost is a story that fills our hearts with fire and our ears with words that we may not understand or want to hear. Pentecost is a story that leads those who take it to heart to repent and reorient themselves to how God is at work in the world. Pentecost is a story that has the power to change how we relate to each other and the world at large. So I look around on this day of Pentecost, given the injustices in the world, given the unrest in our own country, given the complexity of the problem and my own complicity in systems that operate differently for me because of the color of my skin, and I feel the crowd's Pentecostal question deeply. And my heart cries out, "What shall I do?" And somehow the answer hasn't changed. The answer is still repent. It's not a directive to be aimed at others or a thing for us to hurl at those who see the world differently. Rather, the act of repentance is for us. It asks us to examine our own hearts, to acknowledge our own limitations and insecurities and fears. Repentance. It's the work we do to release our own prejudices, preconceived notions, and misconceptions. Repent. It's a call to let my heart be broken, to let it break from my brothers and sisters who are broken and beat down by systems that treat us very differently because of the color of our skin. And I know my words this morning might spark anger in some of you, but that is not my aim. I long for all of us to dwell in unity, to break bread together and give thanks with generous hearts as those first Christians did on that day of Pentecost. I take heart that the spirit of Pentecost, in her desire to hold us together in one accord, invites us not to sit in judgment of one another, but rather to seek understanding. Just as Jesus and then Peter helped others to see how the Messiah could look and sound and act so differently than what they expected, we too need help see how the refining fire of God's love comes to us in ways that are disruptive and uncomfortable. It means listening to the pain and the outrage of people of color who experience the world very differently than those of us whose whiteness has privileged us in ways we may not know or are even ashamed to admit. It means not writing off the outpouring of the Spirit as drunken nonsense or dismissing it because it's confusing or complicated. The story of Pentecost asks us to listen. It asks us to let our hearts be broken. It calls us to repent and bear the name of Christ with renewed courage, humility, and love. And opening ourselves up to the Spirit's transformative power enables us to listen carefully, to serve faithfully, to love deeply, and to live fully into the life that God desires for all of us. So it's in that spirit, the spirit of Pentecost, that I offer you this musical meditation. As we are known by Christ's name, let us also be known by Christ's love. Amen.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity will one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. And all praise to the Father, for through Him all things come. And all praise to Christ Jesus, God's only Son. And all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And we'll guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. We are are one. We are one.
As we move into a time of prayer, there's several things to lift up today. On this day of rejoicing, we give thanks that Dave and Darlene's son Brett made tenure at Mizzou, which is no small accomplishment, so congratulations to him. We also give thanks for the healthy delivery of Lorraine Turner's 14th great-grandchild, a little girl by the name of Halston James. We also give thanks that Bonnie Dexter's surgery went well, and we continue to pray as she waits for the pathology report. We also give thanks that Ed's surgery went well. Again, I said this is a day of rejoicing. We give thanks for a lovely parade on Friday. Thank you to all of those who came out to honor Mary Clark's retirement after teaching in Agape preschool for 30 years. I don't know if Agape preschool years age you faster or keep you young, but we thank Mary for those faithful years of service. We also continue to pray for Eve Lamoro, who will be having her final consultation and hopefully be able to schedule her kidney transplant soon. And of course, we lift up all of those affected by the violence and the protests that are going on. We pray for safety and for peace and for justice. Any other prayer requests here? All right, then, beloved of God, let us enter into this time of prayer by holding and preparing our hearts with a moment of holy silence. God of grace, giver of life, hear our cries for justice and our desire for peace. On this day of Pentecost, we ask you to send your Spirit upon us, your church, in this time of unrest. Stir up our courage and empower us to join the ancient chorus proclaiming Christ crucified. Humble our hearts that we might repent and reorient ourselves to your kingdom. God, we need you. Soften our hearts, open our minds, turn our hands away from violence and our feet away from destruction. God, let us sow seeds of peace. Let us labor together to bear fruits of love. God, today we celebrate the gift of new life, and for jobs that were well done and hard earned. We give thanks for surgeries that went well, and we pray for those that are on the horizon. God, we continue to lift up those who are trying to recover from this pandemic crisis as the world tries to find its footing again. Holy God, we thank you for your faithfulness to us that endures through all generations. We continue to cling to your promise of resurrection and the hope of new life. We thank you that you hear and you answer our prayers, the ones that we put into words and the ones that we don't have words for. We thank you that you hear the cries of our heart, that we can bring you our broken pieces and you give us your peace. So God, as your church is gathered in this time, though we may be scattered in different places, hear us as we lift our voice and cry out to you in the way that you taught us, praying to our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who've sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Beloved of God, I now invite you to sing and proudly declare that we are the church.
Together, all who follow Jesus, all around.
be to God that we are the church. I hope to see as many of you as possible in a few, about a little over an hour on our virtual church picnic. Come as you are, wherever you are. Beloved of God, receive now this benediction. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you as the Spirit burns in your heart, empowering you to proclaim that we serve a risen Savior. Go and bear Christ's name and love in the world. May they know that you are Christian by your love. And all of God's people said, Amen. Amen. Go in peace, people of God.